My robots work because it doesn't use computers, and it is based upon the assumption that a nervous system without a brain can run a robot more efficiently than a brain. And for years, I have fought against the notion, against computer artificial life, because it is only valid inside the computer. But inside a computer, the world is very, very regular, and they try and make little artificial life forms that try and push towards chaos, push towards interesting behavior. In real life, the world is very complex and chaotic. This is real life, artificial life. And the exciting thing is that these are not world models that we create. These are world models that happen inside of our machines. And they happen with the smallest number of components. These devices are getting an essence of self in 20 transistors. In other words, what it would take to build a reasonable radio, we can now make something that can measure and take a sample and a decision on its world. If that's not a definition of life, I don't know what is.
Now meet Dr. Gray Walter of Bristol. Why the torch? Well, here's the reason. It's Toby, a mechanical tortoise with an electronic brain which functions like the human mind. Toby's head, or rather magic eye, is a photoelectric cell constantly revolving until it picks up the strongest source of light, to which it is then attracted. It can also negotiate obstacles. When it hits an object, the pressure on the shell causes a short circuit of the photoelectric cell mechanism, and the tortoise moves at random until it is free of the obstacle.
This is the cricket that we've been doing experiments with recently, which is, as you can see, it's actually a robot. The approach we took was to start very simply. So we built the ears to work the same way as the cricket ears work. And then we tried to connect the ears to the motors to control the behavior with as few bits in between as possible, if you like, as few elements. And what we expected from the cricket experiments was that we'd need quite a lot. We'd need, say, 20 or 30 neurons to control the behavior. But what we found was that we actually only need 4. So what we wanted the robot to be able to do was to be able to play a cricket song and have the robot go towards it. What we found, first of all, when we started it, was that it showed very similar kind of zigzag behavior to the way that crickets move. You can't ever say from a model that therefore it must be the same in the cricket. The cricket could do it a completely different way. What you can say is that the evidence we have about the cricket doesn't show that it's any more complicated than what we have built into the model so far.
You see, fundamentally, it is not at all different from what everybody always did. We made mental models, or models on paper, but models we make, and these models are always simpler than the original. It's somehow in the nature of man to provide simplifying explanations of the bewildering complexity of phenomena around us. That's why robotics is, in a way, nothing new. It's only that aspect, if you call them robots, they become almost living beings. And that aspect may scare people and may look new. That robots lead their own life is an old story. Ideas lead their own life and sometimes go astray and forget their origin.
Ten years ago, in a small desert called Er Chebi at the edge of the Sahara. And at the first moment here, the arachnologists in Germany, they thought it is not a new spider. Yes, it's very exciting that the spider can do both walking with the 8 feet and rolling using 3 pairs of the feet to form a wheel. And the fourth feet, pair of feet, that is, or legs, that is used for rolling. Of course, this movement is much faster and energy saving than if the spider is walking with the 8 feet. Here you see the folding of the robot, to the wheel. It's rolling.
Dr. Walter says that his electronic toys work exactly as though they have a simple two-cell nervous system, and that with more cells, they will be able to do many more tricks. Already, Elsie has one up on Elmer. When her batteries begin to fail, she automatically runs home to her kennel for charging up.
My name's Tony Pike. I'm Professor of Robotics at UWE Bristol, and we've been working with colleagues from University of Sheffield and the University of Bristol for some years on the interface between nature and engineering. This particular robot here, Shrewbot, is modelled on the rodent world, the shrew and rats, that use a sense of touch which is very sensitive for finding out things about the world. The reason we're basing a lot of this research on what is already known or what can be discovered from nature is because there's an existence proof out there. Shrews in particular, the pygmy shrew for example, is only about that long, and it goes out there hunting crickets that are about the same size as itself, and it catches those crickets and disables them and it eats them almost entirely by using its whiskers, and it's very efficient. We're not trying to reinvent the shrew, but there's a great deal that can be learned there.
Back in the early 80s, robots were very, very slow. They would compute for minutes at a time before the robot could move even a meter. And if anything changed in the world in the meantime, they were completely lost what was going on. And I looked around at insects, and insects, you know, could fly around at a meter or so per second. They could avoid getting eaten by a bird. So it seemed to me that maybe we were organizing the computation the wrong way in the way we were approaching robots. When I first started talking about these ideas, the only good thing going for me was I had videotapes of robots really doing things that other robots weren't doing.
Brooks is now chairman of IS Robotics, the bottom-up version of Red Zone.
How are the new tracks going?
Virtually everyone on staff is an MIT alumnus. They all share the dream of putting a robot in every living room.
This week or next week, we'll get that set.
But right now, many of their robots are paid for by the people who brought you duct tape and the internet, the United States military. The IS concept is to build swarms of small, inexpensive robots that can cover terrain too dangerous for troops to enter. This minesweeper is designed to be carried by soldiers into combat.
Other scientists use a completely different approach. They take the brain cells apart and let them grow in a small dish on top of a computer chip.
Let me disconnect the light show.
Dr. DeMars, for instance, tries to communicate with his brain dishes and teach them several tasks.
We take living rat neurons, and they will rapidly form a neural network. And we have this grid of electrodes underneath the surface of these living neurons, and we can listen to the conversation among the neurons. And we can also stimulate activity within that network, and that's how we do what we do.
What he does is to teach his brain dishes how to control an airplane.
Well, they're demanding, though. You have to feed them once a week.
What we did is we invented a system in which you could develop a device. It looks more or less like a robot, in fact, but it's not a robot. And instead of running it by a computer with logic and programs, you simulate a brain in a computer and have the brain controlling the behavior of this device in the real world.
Nomad started out as a newborn, knowing nothing about his world.
He's showing a curiosity that an infant would, but he hasn't really gotten out of, you know, what's in front of him is the most important thing at any given time.
Now that's radically different from what's called artificial intelligence. The artificial intelligentsia actually control robots by writing logical programs and feedback circuits and things of that kind. So let me use the example starting with so-called Darwin 4. By the way, we name these things after the great man.
This is Nomad. He may look like a robot, but he's not. He's an autonomous creature that can actually think and learn. In fact, he can taste this block and decide whether he likes it. Nomad is the only learning machine in the world. He'll be getting a pair of ears soon so he can hear, then later a bigger brain that will allow him to develop short-term memory. Researchers believe Nomad will be able to make decisions based on what he hears and could eventually even think on his own.
We'll be right back.